Tonight's Stadium Series Alumni Game is brought to you by Ram Trucks. Right now, get a great deal during Ram Truck Month. Ram Trucks also brings you the series history. During the seven seasons of the rivalry, the Red Wings won three cups, while Colorado won two. They each appeared in the finals three times, with Detroit winning two of the three Western Conference Finals matchups, and they amassed over 2,300 penalty minutes in 59 games, including 14 game misconducts. Now, Darren, that's a rivalry. Pretty much split down the middle on all those stats.
Yeah, the Stanley Cup won five times, either one or the other won. That really shows you that they were the top two teams, and they had to go through each other's city to get get to the promised land.
Yeah, absolutely. Everything blew up. That's great earned time and value, penalty minutes, fighting majors, game misconducts, but it's about winning.
Right.
And that's what both these franchises did for so long. They were the elite teams in the NHL for quite a few years.
How much did you look forward to the matchup when you were going to play them in the playoffs?
It was penciled in for sure, 100%. I said, you could win seven games in a row, lose to the Avalanche, disheartened, you're upset. That's the game you thought about. That's the game you wanted to win so badly. Their games didn't matter. It was that Avs game that mattered the most.
And they are matched up one more time in the Stadium Series Alumni Game. The Red Wings and the Avalanche from Coors Field in the Mile High City. Ken Daniels and Mike Haynes are on the call. You're going to catch all the action right here on Fox Sports Detroit when we come back.
And welcome back on a warm, spectacular day in Denver. 61 degrees currently, as some of the great older guys renew an old rivalry. One of the best and fiercest the NHL has seen, as we welcome all of you joining us on Fox Sports Detroit, Altitude Sports, NHL Network, and Rogers Sportsnet, coast to coast in Canada. Ken Daniels, television play-by-play voice of the Detroit Red Wings, along with Mickey Redman, Mike Haynes, and Peter McNabb. Bluebird skies in Denver on this majestic late Friday afternoon.
Fans, now direct your attention to the video board as we relive one of the greatest rivalries in the history of sports.
It was the perfect combination of good hockey meets boiling anger.
I think it was the talk of hockey at the time.
It was tremendous, but the respect certainly was there because there were great, great players.
Yzerman, Shanahan, Fedorov, Osgood.
It was about both teams being great hockey teams and wanting to win.
Sackett, Forsberg, Waugh.
They wanted to win.
And it was a rivalry that transcended not just the National Hockey League, but the world of sport.
Coffee and Claude Lemieux, of all people.
Stopped by Waugh. What a close save.
the visiting Detroit Red Wings alumni. Defenseman number 2, Yuri Fisher. Centerman and Hall of Famer number 8, Igor Larionov. Defenseman number 11, Matthew Dandino. And right wing, Hall of Famer number 14, Brendan Shanahan. At right wing, number 17, Doug Brown. At right wing, number 18, Kirk Maltby. At right wing, number 20, Martin Lapointe. Centerman, number 21, Boyd Devereaux. At right wing, Hall of Famer, number 22, Dino Ciccarelli. Also wearing number 22, right wing, Mike Knubel. At center, number 23, Stacy Roots. Defenseman, Hall of Famer, number 24, Chris Chelios. On right wing, number 25, Darren McCarty. Goaltender, number 34, Manny Legacy. Defenseman and Hall of Famer, number 55, Larry Murphy. On the left wing, number 96, Tomas Holmstrom. Defense, captain, and Hall of Famer, number 5, Niklas Lidström. And at center, captain, and Hall of Famer, number 19, Steve Yzerman. Red Wings coaches Dave Lewis, Barry Smith, and Mickey Redmond. Ladies and gentlemen, the Detroit Red Wings alumni. And now, time to introduce the alumni for your Colorado Avalanche. Between the pipes, goaltender, number 1, Craig Billington. With the Avs in 2001. Hall of Famer on defense, number 4, Rob Blake. Also from the 2001 Cup team, defenseman, number 7, Greg DeVries. from the 1996 Cup team. On defense, number 7, Curtis Lecision. Also on defense from the 1996 Cup team, number 8, Sandis Ozelich. Also from the 1996 Cup team, at center, number 9, Mike Ricci. He also won a cup in 1996, left winger, number 12, Chris Simon. He scored the first goal in Avalanche history from the 1996 Cup team on left wing, number 13, Valerie Kaminsky. Also wearing number 13, from the 2001 Cup team on right wing, Dan Hynote. From the 1996 Cup team, right winger and tonight's head coach, number 18, Adam Dedmarsh. He's a Hall of Famer and won 2 cups as a member of the Avalanche. Centerman, number 21, Peter Forsberg. A key component to the 1996 Stanley Cup team, right winger, number 22, member of the 2001 Cup team and former captain, right winger, number 23, Milan Hayduk. A Stanley Cup winner in 1996 and 2001. On defense, number 24, John Clem. From the 1996 Cup team, on right wing, number 25, Mike Keane. Also wearing number 25, a member of the 2001 Cup team, left winger, Sean Cody. A member of the 1996 and 2001 Cup team. At center, number 26, Stefan Yao. From the 2001 Cup team, defenseman and left winger, number 29, Eric Messier. Helped bring Colorado its second Stanley Cup and his first Hall of Fame defenseman, number 77, Ray Bourque. And finally, captain of your Avalanche for 14 seasons, Hall of Famer and 2-time Stanley Cup champion, number 19, Joe. ladies and gentlemen. Now direct your attention, ice level, for tonight's ceremonial face-off. This evening we are joined by Bronze Star Medal recipient, U.S. Army Specialist Marcus Randall. Please hold your applause as we tell Specialist Randall's heroic story. On May 28, 2014, Specialist Randall's platoon was called upon to support a medical evac in the Marut district of Afghanistan. But their helicopter crashed, injuring 13 and killing one. Specialist Randall helped the only medic on board treat the 13 injured soldiers before shifting his efforts and successfully saving the life of their crew chief pinned underneath the helicopter. Also, Specialist Randall placed his own life at risk by climbing under the aircraft to pry Private First Class Weikstra free, allowing his team to take their fallen comrade home for proper honors. Specialist Marcus Randall is a true American hero. Thank you, Specialist Randall, for your bravery and service to our country. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the colors for tonight's anthem is a joint color guard consisting of members from all branches of the United States military. Now, please remain standing and kindly remove your caps as we honor our great nation with the singing of the Star Spangled Banner, as performed this evening by longtime Avalanche anthem singer Jake Schroeder.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
And now we're ready to renew this rivalry as the alumni game set to begin on a beautiful, gorgeous night in Denver, Colorado. Full capacity crowd at Coors Field, and it is shaping up to be one of those memorable nights here in Colorado. The fans here have been so anxious to see this happen again, Ken, and see these two teams representing those great, great players, the great rivalry, those great games, and all those playoff games coming back tonight.
Absolutely, even more so than continuing the rivalry tomorrow. They're all looking forward to this one. 18 skaters in the Hall of Fame between 95 and 02 when this rivalry was really at its fiercest, and we've got 12 in this game here tonight. You're thinking if Nick Lidstrom, Chris Chelios, Rob Blake, and Raymond Bourque were ever on the ice at the same time, 16 Norris trophies for those four.
Then when we saw the introductions and we had the moment where he did a great job of showing the old hockey card, what the players look like, and then we show what they look like now. Tell me a couple of guys you went, wow, they look great. They look like they could still be playing.
Well, Nick Lidstrom, for one, always comes to mind, and everyone will tell you he's still good. Chris Chelios, too, who's in the best of shape of anybody, still rides the bike in the sauna. So he's in terrific shape and an assistant coach for the Red Wings. Chris Draper skates all the time, and there's my broadcast partner on Fox Sports Detroit, Mickey Redman, who's going to man the bench and be with us. So he'll have the microphone down there, and he'll be doing interviews with us, as will be your broadcast partner, Peter McNabb, over on the Colorado bench.
Well, I know as we're going to have the opening face-off here in a moment, you see, the alumni team for both the Red Wings and now the Avalanche getting set. We're going to have a pair of number 19s out at center ice as they drop the puck. Two great captains, two Hall of Famers, fan favorites, and total respect from each side for the other. Joe Sakic against Steve Yzerman. You couldn't have it any more perfect than these two number 19s. Great players. And it's the Red Wings who get the puck to start.
And it's Doug Brown and Boyd Devereaux flanking Steve Yzerman, Nick Lidstrom and Larry Murphy. First 5 and 55 on the back end as it's intercepted.
Oh, it's a steal. Ricci fires. Oh, the first save of the game. Mike Ricci, we talk about players who look like they can still play. Well, Mike Ricci at least looks the same with that long hair.
That's never going to change.
All right, Sakic brings it over the line. Sakic still got that deadly shot. I've seen him working on it. And the long shot from Ray Bourque. Great to see Ray Bourque wearing that number 77. And anybody, whether you're an Avalanche fan, Red Wings fan, or just a hockey fan, everybody remembers that iconic moment of him raising the Stanley Cup over his head after Joe Sakic gave it to him following the 2001 victory for the Avs.
Marty Lapointe wearing number 20. Feeds it off and gets it back. Marty Lapointe out there along with Igor Larionov and Brendan Shanahan, the Maple Leafs president, wearing his familiar number 14.
And you can hear the crowd start to cheer a little bit when number 21 for the Avalanche came out, Peter Forsberg, and he touched the puck.
Boy, Peter Forsberg still knows there's a lot of animosity, and he's at the center of a lot of it as Chris Chelios threw one in on goal. And Patrick Waz got that one, gets a little tap there from Yuri Fischer.
That got the crowd going, and I think fans will remember the fights between these two. Teams, the first you had in 97 in March, it was Patrick Waugh, Mike Vernon at center ice. And then the next year, he called out Chris Oetker, come out, meet me at mid-ice. And then we almost had the Patrick when Dominic Hasek went all the way down the ice and then stepped on the stick, and we didn't get that third goaltender fight.
Just couldn't make it. He was looking for it. I think Patrick was a little surprised he came that way, right in front of his goal again as the Red Wings buzzing the net. Maltby out there along with Stacey Roost for the Red Wings as they have it now in their own zone. Dandenault back on the blue line with Steve Duchesne. As Dandenault gets one back into the Colorado zone, Draper at center for the Red Wings, picked off by Duchesne, and back for Draper. As it's fired back in, goes after it now, and Draper with an opportunity on Patrick Waugh.
I know Patrick Waugh working hard. A lot of road trips going with the Avalanche. Ken saw Patrick Waugh working a lot on getting ready for this game, getting in shape, getting the new pads, and getting set. In fact, said to me, worked a little bit with Francois Lair, the Avalanche coach, working on some of his techniques and learning a couple of things. Well, you know what? Who knows a little bit about what Patrick Waugh was doing? There he is, Peter McNabb, my broadcast partner for the Avalanche. Hey, Peter.
Hey, guys, thanks very much. But just a quick point about Patrick Waugh. A great opportunity to interview him the other day after he had a full practice with the Colorado Avalanche. And you know what he said? I thought it was all about wanting to be, you know, not embarrass yourself, and wanting to be able to play well. He said, no, I just want to enjoy the moment. I want to feel comfortable enough. I know where I'm going to get goals scored on me. I know I'm not going to be at my very best, but I want to enjoy this. This was such an important time in my life, and I just want to have some fun.
And Peter, when you talk to players who are participating in this, is there a sense of appreciating the fact that they had NHL careers and they get a chance to come back out and play a game they love?
Well, you know what? It's been, you know, I talked to a lot of the players during warm-up and whatever. It has won. They cannot believe the number of people that are here. They cannot believe how many people have come out to see this game. And the buzz that was around, I don't think Detroit, I don't think the National Hockey League, I don't think the Avalanche players who were coming in from out of town, the alumni, realized how important this team was to the fabric of this 20-year rivalry, 20 years now in Colorado. And to a man, they've been amazed.
I know. I don't know how it was in Detroit, Ken, but I know for the Avalanche, just dealing and talking with fans, this is all they wanted to talk about. They wanted to talk about this alumni game. Yes, tomorrow means something in the standings because there's playoff implications coming for both teams. But the fans who grew up or they had mom and dad loving the game and enjoying this rivalry, they couldn't wait for this. The Avs are moving that puck around. There's Adam Foote. And his shot gets tipped wide. Mike Ricci back behind the Red Wing net trying to make something set up. Oh, he was loved. Mike Ricci. The fans just loved Ricci when he was playing for the Avalanche. One of their true fan favorites.
And really loved everywhere he went, Mike Ricci. You hated to play against him, but you loved playing with him as Patrick Roy stops that one and moves it. Patrick said when he started his career, he's 164 pounds. He's now around 195. So a lot different there, and the equipment's a lot different, too. Not nearly as heavy as it was when he started. That'll help him.
Oh, there's Claude Lemieux.
Pass out front,
and there is a goal, and this Valley Convention. How fitting is that? He scored the very first goal in the history of the Colorado Avalanche against the Detroit Red Wings. And all these years later, he scores the first goal of the alumni game. So fittingly perfect.
He beats Ty Conklin.
Well, Lemieux able to dish it off, and then the pass, and Kamensky. And what's this line, you see, of course, who set it up there? That was Peter Forsberg. This line, Ken, Kamensky, Forsberg, and Lemieux just fit together. It didn't seem like it would be a natural line when you have three completely different styles of players in Forsberg, Lemieux, and Kamensky. But when they were together, it was a magical line for the Avalanche. Great to see them again together.
And this line for the Red Wings buzzing with Marty Lapointe, Igor Larionov, and Brendan Shanahan. Well, there's a number 20, Marty Lapointe. Mickey Redmond wore number 20 as well for the Red Wings. Mick?
I can tell you what, guys. Normally in these alumni games, it takes to the second and a half or third period for things to heat up, but they're already going strong here in the first 5-6 minutes of this game, and there's some body contact, some sticks are flying. I'll tell you what, they're into it. It's good stuff.
Would you be surprised if something happened in this game?
Not one bit. Not a bet.
And you'll be happy for it.
That's right.
Keep sending the tough guys over the boards, Mick.
Oh, I got enough of them.
It's great stuff. These guys are having a ball. They're really enjoying it, I'm telling you. They're into it right off the hop, and they know as we go along here, this thing's going to ramp up and ramp up. So you can imagine if it's this way in the first 5-6 minutes, we got a big treat in for you in the rest of this game.
Three 20-minute periods of running time for this game, and the weather's so great, you won't need the heaters on the bench, that's for sure.
Well, we've got the one goal coming at 5:07. Forsberg, beautiful assist, as you could expect from Peter Forsberg. Kamensky and Lemieux also involved in that goal, with Kamensky getting the even strength goal. So the Avs are up 1-0 against Detroit here at Coors Field. It's alumni night. Ray Bourque handling the puck for Colorado. Down low, and a chance for Eric Messier. Number 29 for the Avalanche.
Thomas Holmstrom out there for the Red Wings, along with the Chris Draper and Dino Cicerelli. Two number 22s for the Red Wings. One, Mike Knubel, who's now coaching in Grand Rapids with their American Hockey League team. And Dino Cicerelli, the other number 22 for Detroit, as they will get a whistle. The referees are Bob Hall and Don Adam. You had the feeling at the start of the game they should have pulled a little slap shot and gone over to the... If you guys try anything dirty in this game.
That's right. Well, you look back on the playoff history, and ultimately, everything else that happened, it all led to the playoffs. And I think both teams knew, Ken, you're probably going to have to go through the other if you want to get to that Stanley Cup. And there were some phenomenal playoff series that were so hard fought and so much talent in those playoff series. Boy, that was just so much fun to watch all those years. Those two great teams going at it seemingly every season. Patrick Roy loves to play the puck, got it out to center.
And now it's Chelios who brings it back in for the Red Wings. He's checked the Colorado line and swept back to the Detroit blue line, and a quick feed through center again, and the Red Wings will get it in.
Ray Bourque, he played in that Boston Bruin Montreal alumni game that happened right before the Winter Classic this year. And he looked good there. Chance for Milan Hajduk. His tip back towards Hajduk. Nice little pass. Josakic puts the brakes on, and Hajduk couldn't get the shot away. He got blocked. In the slot, here's a chance again for Ricci. That puck seems to be finding him tonight.
Turning is Chelios, who feeds one back. Sent out to center by Yuri Fisher, whose career ended all too early. And Yuri Fisher, director of player development for the Red Wings. And if you look at him, boy, he's another one who could still play today, but for the health. And he's been dynamite there for the Red Wings. They threw it in front of the goal for Dan and all. Loose puck in front, and they score! The Red Wings have tied up the game. Steve Yzerman gets the goal. He loved playing at Comerica Park against Toronto in the alumni game, so much so that he said he wouldn't miss this one, even with the trade deadline for his Tampa Bay Lightning and for the league coming up on Monday, going to the net, and he buries it, beating Patrick Waugh. So Steve Yzerman ties up this game after Kaminsky gave Colorado the lead. The Red Wings alumni and Avalanche alumni tied at one at Coors Field in Denver.
So great was how many great players there were. When you look at the Colorado Avalanche and their Hall of Famers that played for the team between 95 and 02. Look at that. Sacking, Forsberg, Waugh, Bork, Blake, Curry.
And for the Red Wings, with eight of them in this game tonight, and really the acquisition of Larry Murphy was so important from Toronto at the trade deadline, March 18th of 97, to be paired with Nick Lidstrom, and they're out there now, along with Igor Larionov from Brendan Shanahan. So some of the Hall of Famers for the Red Wings on the ice right now as Nick Lidstrom puts one through as Shanahan comes in for it, and tried to center one back in front. Knocked away. Shanahan working in back of the goal. Looks to center one. Igor Larionov picks it up. Igor Larionov now a player agent. Threw one into the middle. Blocked in front of the goal. A point looking for. Marty Lapointe, director of player personnel for the Montreal Canadiens.
A couple great blocks there by John Klemp. Let's go down to the Avalanche bench with Peter McNabb. Peter.
Hey, guys. Thanks very much. I'm here with Joe Sakic. Joe, 20 years ago, you were part of a club that came here. Now you're the general manager of this hockey club. You got to look around here and be really proud of what you guys have done here in Colorado with hockey.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what a great venue. It's Coors Field. Couldn't have it in a better place. And you see the crowd here, sold out, and even for a bunch of old stiffs like us. But, we had great memories with this club, a six-year span. What a rivalry, and you could even tell right now, nobody wants to embarrass themselves. Everybody's having fun out here, but I think both teams want to win, too.
Oh, absolutely, and just maybe without too many of the stories being told, what was last night when you guys all got together and really were able to reminisce with the Red Wings and yourselves and just be in the locker room?
Oh, you know what, absolutely. We gathered both teams. We had a function last night that I think everybody had a great time. It was great to catch up with your old teammates and some of the Detroit guys as well. And for sure, we talked a lot about the rivalry, and I think it's something that, on both sides, you could probably talk about that forever because we had great memories.
Well, Joe, thanks so much. And again, congratulations to you and the Colorado Avalanche organization. This is quite a night.
It's a great day. And, we thank all the fans here in Colorado. What a great turnout. And they've always been supporting us. And we're going to get back there.
Okay. Right. Guys, back to you.
And right. Joe Sakic, who had one of the best shots when you guys were at Joe Louis Arena a few weeks ago and he was practicing with Patrick Waugh there. I said, you still got it. He said, my shot's not there. The skating's okay, but the shot's not there. I said, I don't think that ever leaves you. Not him.
Not for Joe Sakic.
Not for Joe.
He's being very modest.
Yes, he was.
He can still shoot the puck. That's for sure.
As the Red Wings will regroup at their own line, there's Stacey Roost, who's involved in player development with the Tampa Bay Lightning, working with Steve Yzerman, who came in for the game, and they'll fly back shortly after. And there's Thomas Holmstrom on the Red Wings. Shots right now 7-2 at this juncture for Detroit in this game.
Yeah, game tied up at one, and there's Holmstrom, and Avalanche fans certainly remember how much time he spent right in front of Patrick Waugh, trying to deflect pucks, trying to screen, trying to make things happen in front of the net.
And it's amazing, in the season series, regular season, and playoffs combined, but Detroit and Colorado. Thomas Holmstrom had the third most goals. Joe Sakic the most of 24. Then Brendan Shanahan and Thomas Holmstrom at 21. I asked him prior to the game, and he come from more than 2 feet. He said maybe a few from three, but that's about it. But you don't really think of Thomas Holmstrom in this series as having the third most goals.
Well, he certainly was around that net a lot of times and getting ready for those goals.
And one of the best at deflecting pucks in front, although Dino Cicerelli, a Hall of Famer, will tell you he was the best, and that's a little dispute that Holmstrom and Cicerelli have between them.
All right, Avalanche with the puck, and quick pass up ice for Eric Messier. One-on-one chance, and his shot gets deflected wide, and the Red Wings get it back.
And try to get one into the Colorado zone as Dandenault did work it in there, centered back out front, and that shot is blocked.
The
Holmstrom in his office.
Yeah, now all of a sudden they go back to Sakic at its center and trying to flip the puck in. Got it blocked, but it's fouled by Bork. He finds Sakic. Sakic moving in. Look out for that shot. And it's a goal. Yeah, we just talked about it. Joe Sakic, lightning fast rifter. And it still works for Super Joe as he's giving the Avs the lead back 2-1. Boy, he snapped that shot after getting the pass from Bork. Just walked in, they got plenty of room, and when he shoots, you give him that kind of time, that kind of space, Super Joe's gonna score, and he's put the Avs ahead 2-1. Joe Sakic and his Roosters just put the Avs ahead 2-1. He lines up against Eisman, who scored the Red Wings goal. So those two greats have already put a show on for the fans.
And Joe Sakic with 63 combined points in the regular season and playoffs between these two great teams, trailing only Nick Lidstrom, who had 77 in the time of this rivalry, as the Avalanche bring it into Red Wing territory.
Hey, Duke still with those great hands, still stick handle his way through some traffic. The Avs keep it in play in the Red Wing zone. Back towards the blue line. John Klemm of the Avalanche. He's a real good all-round defenseman, dependable, could play a little forward if you needed him to.
That's Boyd Devereaux bringing it in for the Red Wings. One-third of the original line of two kids and an old goat for Detroit, along with Pavel Datsyuk and Brett Hull.
Kamensky with a shot. He scored the first goal of this game, and that time he was denied by the Red Wings goaltender.
By the way, I should mention the two kids and the old goat with Boyd Devereaux, Brett Hull, and Pavel Datsyuk in his rookie season. You know, Brett Hull would tell you that goat stands for greatest of all time.
Right?
Of course he would.
Of course.
he's not an old goat, just the greatest of all time. He's one of the greatest there. Igor Larionov on this draw against Forsberg. And interesting that those two started it all, didn't they, really? They got together, and it was Larionov and Forsberg who really began the tussle of this series when it all went the way that maybe loved. And
right there in 97, everybody remembers Lemieux, McCarty, Waugh, Vernon, but it all started when Forsberg and Larionov were battling it out, and that everybody was looking towards that when Lemieux was jumped by McCarty.
Oh, Patrick Waugh got over maybe with some help from Foot there.
Hey, guys, I got to tell you just a quick story. When Joe Sakic scored that goal, the smiles on the Avalanche bench, every single player just looking at each other like, he still got it. And you know, guys, honestly, you know that every one of them had a memory about a Joe Sakic shot, his ability to just come down that wing and just unload the wrist shot. And they were just smiling and just, you know, you could just see.
And Peter, was the same thing there when Forsberg made his pass to Kamensky, too?
Exactly. Well, that line, I was listening to you guys, that line was magic.
Yep.
But, you know, they were just on the bench, and they just, you know, there's a special quality. Eisenman, Sakic, Forsberg. There's a special group that, you know, are just the best of the best during their time. And the guys, they appreciate just how well these guys could play and can still do some things.
And by looking at this game so far, I'd say the pace is pretty darn good.
I would be surprised if the pace was this fast in the third period, I got to tell you.
Now, Peter, and you play at altitude, there is a difference, right?
I've already had that about five times, guys going by. Yeah, I forgot about the altitude. And that's what I said to me. You know what? It doesn't get any easier as this game goes along.
Well, and in part, and that's why Darren McCarty, over the past year or so, and he's lost 15 to 20 pounds, he said he had to, knowing going into this game, there would be a big problem.
Oh, it's, and I'll tell you, I must admit, of all the things I'm impressed with, it's how good the guys look physically.
There was McCarty taking a shot.
And Darren McCarty said, I don't want to have a coronary on the ice. That's what they probably hope for. The Denver fans, he said, they'd love it. They're hoping I'm coming in overweight and out of shape, and wouldn't that be the end to that one?
You think the Avalanche fans here, if all of a sudden he had that heart attack?
Well, and yes, he said his wife gave him heck for saying coronary because he figured, I wouldn't use a big word like that. It would have to be heart attack. It would have to be two words. But a great chance. Shanahan with a nice little dish. And a good chance there from Marty Lapointe, Mick.
Boy, oh boy, I'll tell you what. You were talking about Peter McNabb was talking about Joe Sakic and that great shot of his. Do you see those plays that Lidstrom just made in front of Patrick Roy? The guys on the bench were going, oh, my God, are you kidding me? Lidstrom pulled that off again. One too many, and he just about put it in the back of the net. But that's the kind of stuff that Hall of Famer can do.
Well, and we had Nick Lidstrom with us at the Red Wing game the other night as the Red Wings honored Nick Lidstrom for his Hall of Fame induction. And we asked him, seeing what Jaromir Jagr's doing now, if maybe he retired too early. He said, no, he's pretty good. Good where he's at, but most know that if Nick wanted to still be playing now a few years later, he still could be.
He's not playing hardly at all. He's skating with the kids over in Sweden and teaching them, but he's just an absolute natural, and riding a bike, I guess so, for Lidstrom any day of the week.
Hey, Mickey, anybody else on the Red Wing team that looks just in great shape, ready for this game today?
Keep your eye on number two. Yuri Fisher is one stud of a hockey player. He's unfortunate with that accident that he had, that the guys talked about with the heart problem. But, I mean, he's in incredible shape, and he can fly out there, and he means business. He can really let her go.
Lapointe gave it back to Larionov. Back of the net for Shanahan. Shanahan feeds it off to the wing. Larionov down low, looks in front, goes back to the line, and it deflects back out to center ice. And to think that when the Red Wings were winning the Cup in 02 with that Hall of Fame team, Larionov, Holmstrom, and another number 20, Luke Robitaille was the fourth line for Detroit. My, how the game has changed. The times have changed.
I was just looking at that bench right there to see if it Mickey and Peter are talking about, see if there's a lot of heavy breathing going on as the guys are coming back off the ice.
Well, Steve Yzerman, I don't think Steve Yzerman has even really laced them up since the last alumni game that he had played in with the Red Wings against the Toronto Maple Leafs.
And for fans who don't know, now the general manager for the Tampa Bay Lightning, and you think with the trade deadline coming up on Monday, how wonderful it was for him to take the time this weekend to come and participate in this.
Yeah, Chris Draper was with Steve at their Muskoka Cottage last summer, and Steve said he'd love to play, and Drapes thought that was great, and then he found out it was right around the trade deadline, but still, he had such a good time last time he wanted to be a part of it. So three 20-minute periods for this game, and the running time in the first 20 has run out. And we've seen, as we talked about, a great pace, Mike, to start this game.
Well, in some fitting things. We saw Kamensky, who scored the first ever goal for the Avs against the Red Wings, gets the first one tonight. We saw the two greats, Yzerman and Sakic, do what they can do.
As we send it down to Mickey Redmond. Mick.
Thanks, guys. What do you think? You don't get a chance to skate much being the general manager in a tough league. How do you feel with this mountain air?
I'm keeping my shift short. It's. I remember the game in Detroit was the same way. First couple of shifts, the excitement, adrenaline stops, and you're sucking air, and your legs are burning. It's a lot of fun. It really is.
I can't help but ask you. You dropped the puck. You went to the front of the net, and bingo, the puck is there off the goalpost. Oh, that's got to feel great.
I almost missed it. I had a wide open net and almost missed it. Scott is telling me all the time, go to the net. It took till the age of 50 to figure it out.
Great to see you here. Good to see both number 19s put the puck in the net. Thanks, Steve.
A lot of fun. Thanks, Mick.
All right, guys. Take care.
All right, Mickey, thank you very much. And the Red Wings trail the Avs 2-1 after that first period in Colorado. My favorite moment, of course, in that first period, a lot of Red Wings fan favorite moments will be Stevie Yzerman scoring that goal. What about you, Ozzy?
I just think the intent, this is an organized game. Usually there's tons of breakaways, there's tons of two-ons. That's not the case. There was one right after the start, and that was really it. I'm just defensively organized. They're blocking shots. There was more block shots in this first period than there was in the Minnesota game that was played in Minnesota alumni game as well. But this, I love the intensity. Are they going to be able to keep this up?
Well, that's wow. Mickey talked about it, right? He said that these kind of games, you don't see this in the first period very often. Can they keep it up? I think they will. One of the cool kind of things about this, Valerie Kamensky, scored the first goal in Colorado Avalanche history against the Red Wings in a win way back in 1995. Who scores the first goal of this game? Valerie Kamensky against the Red Wings. Kind of a one of those cool little things that go along with these kind of historical games. Nice play, too. Bang, bang, play.
Yeah, one I thought Conklin should have had.
Goaltending, come on.
Oh. Yeah, no chance on that one. Poor Conklin. You haven't played for about 4 years, and you're trying to stretch across here. Just be thankful you're not injured, but it's kind of cool. And Kaminsky, this is one of these guys, unreal player when I played against him. He still has his handles. Watch him stick handle. He still has the great mitts and a great shot. So what an entertaining first period.
It was fun to see Yzerman score, of course, yeah. But his counterpart, number 19, the captain of the Avs, Joe Sakic, lit up the lamp as well, Derek.
Yeah, you know, you could tell that Steve Yzerman was really thrilled to score a goal. Think of all the big goals he's scored. This is more like a relief, but still a little bit of satisfaction with Steve Yzerman scoring. I'm sure Joe Sakic felt the same way. Yzerman, as he was talking with Mick, just go to the front of the net, finally learned that trick at the age of 50. Not giving himself enough credit, but he had a big, beaming smile on the bench.
What a drive to the net by Dano. Good coaching. Like, wow, you got these guys. And this shot, I don't care who's in the net, when you're in the net, how old you are, how much you've been playing, you're not stopping that.
Oh, come on, short side.
Joe Sakic. Please, that shot is unstoppable even when you're playing on a regular basis. He has one of the best shots ever in the National Hockey League.
It was funny. We saw him at the Joe when they were in town. He was out there skating with Patrick Roy, and his wrist shot was all over the ice. He was like, I can't even hit the net. He was worried about it. Looked like the old Joe Sakic in that instance.
Well, they're calling it an alumni game. It could really be called a Legends game. 19 Hall of Famers squared off in the 7 years that this rivalry was in its prime. Let's have a look at the Colorado Avalanche and their player profile. It's brought to you by your Southeast Michigan Ford dealers. And they have 6 Hall of Famers in their lineup. Joe Sakic, Peter Forsberg, Yari Curry, Rob Blake, and Patrick Waugh were all Hall of Famers when this rivalry was at its peak. And as for the Red Wings, more than double the number of Hall of Famers on their roster. Their Hall of Fame roster is brought to you by Priority Health, and there you'll see 13 Hall of Famers led by the captain, Steve Yzerman. And guys, when you look down the list like this, it just gives you chills.
It does. I remember the 0-2. I was working for NHL Radio and was on the bench. And Luc Robitaille and Steve Duchesne were teammates of mine with the LA Kings. And they tried. They won the Cup for the first time, both of them. They're at the end of their career. They were depth guys. And they came over, and they were almost wanting to try to share that moment with me. It was so cool to see them so excited, even though they were just role players at that time of their career.
That was ridiculous. I was looking at that list.
It's crazy.
That's crazy. I don't think you're ever going to see something like that ever again. I mean, that's just wonderful. Obviously, the fans realize that it's a sold-out game here, and it's an intense game. So I'm enjoying it. Darren thinks they can keep it up. I think they can. We'll see, though.
In just a few years, you'll add the name Chris Osgood to that list as well. It was quite a star-studded list it was. We've got more coming between periods as the Avs and the Red Wings alumni are getting it on in the Mile High City. Avs up 2-1 after one. Tonight's Stadium Series Alumni Game is brought to you by your local Toyota dealers. Visit buyatoyota.com. Toyota, let's go places. And by Arby's. Right now, get 2 crispy fish filet sandwiches for only 5 bones. We're coming back between periods between the Avs and the Wings. The Stadium Series Alumni Game is led by Colorado by 1 after 1. Back inside the studio, Darren Elliott, Chris Osgood, along with you as the Red Wings and the Avs are playing that alumni game in Colorado. Valerie Kamensky and Joe Sakic for the Avs. Steve Yzerman has replied for the Red Wings. And guys, we saw some intensity in that first period. Some block shots, actually.
Did we ever? We saw some back-checking by some players, most of them, actually. And this was not an ordinary alumni game so far. These guys are going end-to-end here, playing a full rink game, but right here, block shots, come on. And that wasn't the only time Clem did it. This was 2 or 3 times he was down. He had another fabulous one after, but then the back-checking by the Red Wings.
But also, Clem blocks the shot, gets up, keys the breakout. Like, that's the intensity that you don't think they can keep this up.
These guys have a banquet after. They got to save themselves a little bit. They got some fun to be had after this game. They're going to blow themselves out here.
How tough is it going to be the next 2 periods in the altitude?
You have to think it's going to slow down a bit, but I think the third's going to be really intense.
Well, the Red Wings have a little bit of work to do. They're down by 1 as we head to the second period at Coors Field in the Mile High City of the Red Wings and the Avs in the Stadium Series Alumni Game. Future alumni, but they've got a long way to go to catch up to the talent they're watching on the ice at Coors Field tonight.
Game 6, 1996 Conference Finals. The Avs won that game, won the series, but that hit by Claude Leo on Draper then resulted in the next year with McCarty, and then the following year, Lemieux responded on Darren McCarty, opening faceoff, they were ready to go, and Lemieux felt that he had to justify what had happened.
And it took 19 years before Chris Draper and Claude Lemieux had a conversation, and it was at the draft in Miami last June, and Claude Lemieux, one of his clients, Jorn Van Puttelberg, is a draft pick of the Detroit Red Wings, and Chris Draper said he was sort of taken aback when Claude walked up to them in the hotel lobby. He said, my son's eyes were bugging out. I couldn't believe it. There was no apology, but they had a nice conversation, and Chris Draper said he really wasn't expecting an apology from Claude, but they did have a nice conversation and just tried to put things aside.
And then in the Denver papers today, talking about Claude, you said everything's fine. You talk, you see each other.
I don't think from Chris's perspective, everything is fine.
I'm just saying, everybody's got their side, right?
That's right. Three sides to every story. Yours, mine, theirs, that's the right. Truth. Somewhere in there, Mickey Redmond, any thoughts?
Yeah, guys, it was very interesting. Before we dropped the puck here for the second period, you looked around and out on the ice was Milan Hayduk, Yuri Fischer speaking in their native tongue, Larionov and Kamensky communicating in Russian. You had Shanahan and Blake talking about league matters. They both work for the NHL. And wouldn't you believe it, Patrick Waugh talking to Chris Chelios. That I wouldn't have believed.
As Larionov keeps it in and a drop pass back for Fischer, and there's Chelios to backhand it in deep. Shanahan looks to center one, he did. And a good chance there again for Yuri Fischer.
And a great save from Patrick Waugh. And Claude Lemieux, we were just talking about him coming in, trying to make a pass across for his linemate Peter Forsberg.
And a nice play by Chelios to get a stick down there to intercept it, and a lead pass at center for Boyd Devereaux, who carries in along with Larionov. They can't get through.
And the Avs come back in. Chris Simon, when he played, I don't know if there's anybody tougher, more feared in the league when Chris Simon, when he was at the peak, when he was about as tough as they came in the National Hockey League. And that year, 96, he did a great job of protecting his teammates and was able to chip in with a number of goals, too.
Steve Yzerman made a nice play defensively to get one ahead for Devereaux as it's carried back into the Colorado zone, and a good back check here by the Avalanche.
And again, on the move, here come the Colorado Avalanche again. Team puts it out in front for Simon, but he got tipped wide of the net. Well, let's go back to the Avalanche bench here again. Peter McNabb.
Hey, thanks very much, guys. I'm down here with Claude Lemieux. Claude, you see the Red Wings and yourself. Does it bring back memory? I mean, does it get real quick?
Yeah, I mean, you know, watching the introduction and all these great players out there brought back a lot of memories, and it's great to be out here.
You know, when your name was announced, and you saw it in the Jumbotron, and the reception, it must have been something to feel it coming from, a packed house at Coors Field.
It's such an amazing crowd. I'm surprised. I was expecting maybe half of that, but, you know, we've always had wonderful fans here, and the history and this rivalry, and it's great to relive this one more time.
And, you know, again, I always say it, but there's no place like a locker room with good friends, is there?
Absolutely. It's like we've never lost a day. We've lost a step or two or three, but we just catch up, and it's like old times.
Thanks so much, Clark. Appreciate it. Guys?
And we'll hear from Darren McCarty in a few moments. He's out there right now on the ship with the Grindliners, his mates Malpe and Draper, and he'll be heading to the bench. It was interesting, though, that everyone talks about the Draper and the Lemieux hit, and then to hear Adam Foote, when they said to him, and I was on Colorado radio, whom he detests most on the Red Wings, and he said it was Chris Draper because it was all about Draper and Lemieux, and Foote said, I get hit by Kozlov. I'm cut for stitches in that game, too. Nobody talks about that. And he said, all I hear about is Chris Draper. He said, he just turns my stomach, and that's a direct quote, and I was surprised this many years later.
Oh, it hasn't gone away yet.
No, and Adam Foote, he said they were on a flight together in turn, and who's he seated next to as he gets on? He said Chris Draper, and he said Drapes smirks at me, and I thought, boy, oh boy, just they don't see eye to eye, and that's for sure. And we mentioned Darren McCarty, Mickey Redmond's with him.
Oh dear, you going on the next shift?
No, I'm passing on to Coors.
You're not double shifting, but how about the days when you did and this rivalry and this crowd today?
Oh, this is unbelievable, Mick. I mean, you look around even to come out and see all these fans. This is a great conclusion to probably the last great hockey rivalry. So to be a part of this and to see how, you know, guys are going out here working hard and having fun. And Yeah, we're both trying to win.
Pace a little bit bigger than the first period than normal with him.
Well, it's going to keep picking up, and I'll tell you this, there's not a lot of arrow here.
Keep it going, Max.
All right, thank you.
Big hit of the game, and Thomas Holmstrom went down back of the Colorado goal behind Patrick Roy.
When the players were introduced, Darren Riccardi got more boos from the Colorado Avalanche fans. When you have a rivalry like this, you have to have guys that wear the black hats. You have to have people that you just don't like if you're the opposing team's fans. And for the Avalanche, it's Darren Riccardi. He's got the biggest black hat.
And didn't you love the salute, though, he gave to the crowd? And made sure he went to all sides here at Coors Field. It was wonderful. Chris Draper just blowing a bubble when they booed him. And Chris Chelios told the crowd, yeah, boo me, and went right back at him. That's great stuff. As Chelios tries to center one now, he's hitting along the boards. Poster goes in back of the net.
Forsberg, that's a long pass. He can still make those plays. Kaminsky moving in. The drop for Lemieux. The shot got blocked, and the Red Wings got it back.
That's Yuri Fisher who will bring it out to center ice. Into the Avalanche zone. He's checked. Eisenman was looking for that loose puck and turned back into the Red Wings zone. With it now is Boyd Devereaux. Devereaux, always a great skater. Leaves it there for Chris Chelios. Played to the age of 48.
As they regroup, as they try to get out of their own zone, the long pass got tipped out of center, then across, and Simon sends it down the slot, gets a shot away, and that was deflected back to the corner. And once again, Chris Simon. The center in front, scramble for the puck, and the Red Wings get it back for a moment.
Devereaux was up there along with Matthew Dandineau, one of the great skaters in the National Hockey League, who played both forward and defense. Flipped out by Lapointe to center, and the Red Wings will regroup for Duchesne. Steve Duchesne, who had a wonderful National Hockey League career, great offensive defenseman. That pass went astray. And out to play it is Conklin. This will be an icing call against Colorado.
Gentlemen, well, you guys were talking about it heating up a little bit. It certainly has here in the second period. Ray Bourque behind the net on Holmstrom, and then Adam Foote with Chris Chelios. And then later on, when we didn't get, Draper knocked down Foote from behind with a cross check. So, gentlemen, in the first 07 minutes here in the second period, it started to get a little interesting on the ice.
Well, as we said, if anyone was going to go at one another, it might be Foote and Draper, and more from Adam Foote's side, I think. Turning to get it is Larry Murphy. Go ahead, Peter.
Yeah, I'm just going to say, it's so interesting because, you know, the first period there was a lot of, you know, smiles, and everybody was having a good time. There's no question. The smiles are a little bit less, and there's a seriousness that's starting to come over this thing because, as Joe Sakic said, neither team wants to lose. And, you know, it's 2-1 right now in this hockey game, and you're going to start to see the competitive nature come out pretty quickly.
There's Lidstrom with a shot that was blocked up there along with Larionov, so we'll see fewer and fewer smiles by the time the third period rolls around. Lapointe goes back to the line for Larry Murphy, and the shot just deflected in wide. Shanahan with an outstretched stick able to haul that puck back in for Murphy, who was in his time, you know, four-time cup winner, one of the best in the National Hockey League ever at keeping the puck in at the point, was Larry Murphy. And the number 55 back to get it with a quick outlet pass for his defense partner, Nick Lidstrom. And so integral to the Red Wing Cup victories back in 97 and 98. So with that, we'll step out on a beautiful night here in Denver at Coors Field and a 2-1 Avalanche lead.
Oh, goals from Valerie Kamensky, Joe Sakic for the Avalanche, Steve Eisenman for the Detroit Red Wings, and we're in the second period of this alumni game, and one of the things that is really nice we're doing tonight, several players are going to have microphones. It is Sean Podine. There he is. Hey, Sean. It's Mike Hames up in the booth. How you doing?
Mike, what's up, buddy? How you doing?
Sean, just wondering. You're one of those guys that jumped into the rivalry as it was going on. You know, what was it like to jump into this rivalry the way that it was set up for the players?
It was unbelievable. The intensity and the way they played against each other and the way that when each team played, when the Red Wings and the Avalanche played, the level of play was at highest and pushing both teams to be their best. And every game was like that. Every game was intense. It was just a great rivalry to be part of and come into.
Boy, Stacy Roos just a couple of great opportunities and couldn't bury him for Detroit to get this game even. And Patrick Waugh with a couple of great saves.
Sean, you know, you obviously the guys have slowed down a little bit, but you can still see those guys that can do it, can't you?
Oh, my goodness. You look at the high-end talent that's on this ice and what they can still do with the pucks, still move their feet, the plays they make. It's just a pleasure to have a seat like this to watch them.
Sean, as this game is going on, you're starting to feel a little bit the altitude?
Oh, I've been feeling it since the first shift. I keep telling our coach to start shortening the bench and he won't do it. No, but it's fun. I mean, you can see it's interesting to see how the pace of the play goes here towards the end of the second period going into the third.
Because we were just watching and it seemed like the first period, there was a little bit of carefree. It's starting to get a little more serious.
Oh boy, is it ever. And you kind of expected that with these two teams. That's no surprise, I think, to anybody. Thanks so much, guys. Enjoy the game.
Manny Legacy, as you can see, has taken over in goal for the Red Wings, who went for a couple of tries there from Stacy Roos. This game would be all even.
Well, the Red Wings are certainly getting the shots, Ken. 18-5 in the course of the game, and Avs have yet to get a shot on net during the second period of play.
So it's a good thing Patrick Waugh has been practicing for a little bit.
Yes,
he hadn't played since the Canadiens' 100th anniversary a little, and he's really been working hard to get back at it. There's a shot from Shanahan. Larionov, as Murphy at the point, couldn't get in the puck. Good move by the man they call the professor, Larionov. Nick Lidstrom couldn't get through, and the Avalanche take over.
Yeah, Lemieux, quick long pass of ice for Kaminsky. He's got Forsberg trailing. Flips it over to Lemieux, shoots. And that stopped another chance as Kaminsky threw one to the front of the net. He's got a goal already in this game. Nice looking pass from Forsberg, but it got tipped away.
And tipped away by the perfect stick of Nick Lidstrom. It's not to knock it away as we check in at the Red Wing bench with one of the head coaches, Mickey Redman.
Thanks, Ken. Mr. Holmstrom, you've been known.
Hey, I got to do that.
You're going next. You've been known to agitate some people over the years. What happened to Ray Bourque back there?
I don't know. I was leaning on the wrong foot.
What did you say to him? Did you say anything to him after he knocked you down?
No, not really. I knocked him down over here, stepped up, so now he's good at me, so it's 1-1.
Good to see you back in Red Wing uniform and in this game.
Thank you.
Thomas Holmstrom getting ready to go. Where's number 96 when he was trying to decide what number to take with the Red Wings? He wanted 10 until he was told, well, that's retired for Alex Delvecchio. Scotty Bowman was nearby, and they said, what number do you want? And Thomas said, I'll take 96. It's the year I came. And Scotty Bowman replied, why don't you take 98? It's the year you're leaving.
Wow.
Scotty could throw the digs at the best of time, and Thomas Holmstrom, nicknamed the Demolition Man. Well, he got demolished in back of the net there by one Raymond Bourque. And Thomas Holmstrom, although Demolition Man, is now in the building business back in Sweden.
Hey, we just saw a moment ago. We see Chris Simon there in the corner. There he is, number 12. But going right to the, talking about how tough he is. I just saw sitting a moment ago in the Red Wing, just coming off the ice, Joey Koser. Hey, maybe the hardest punch.
Yes, I would say so. You could break helmets.
Oh, my goodness. He had hands the size of canned hams.
Oh, yeah.
He could hurt you when he hit you.
Joey Koser, who heads up the Red Wings Alumni Association, such an integral part, and the Avalanche alumni and the Red Wings alumni do wonderful jobs that much isn't talked about in what they do in the community as well.
Chris Simon, who played the National Hockey League for years and went over to Russia and played for a while as well. There he is, Dino Cicerelli. Chris Simon. Remember, he had that long hair down his back, and now no hair. Several Avalanche players. Eric Messier, Mike Keane came in. No hair.
Still one of the best lines was from Dino Cicerelli after that playoff series, and he replied with Claude Lemieux, I can't believe I shook his hand. After all that had gone down, but that is what hockey does when series are over, and that's what you do regardless of what took place on the ice. As there is Thomas Holmstrom. Drops it back, and Moi came out on that shot. And ricochets back out to center ice. Ken Daniels along with Mike Haynes, Mickey Redman,
Peter McNabb, glad you're with us on Fox Sports Detroit, on Altitude, the NHL Network, and Sportsnet, coast to coast in Canada. And puck deflected, yeah, Legacy is able to knock that puck away. There's Mike Knuble. Trying his hand at coaching now with the Griffins. Steve Yzerman with a perfect pass. Devereaux on the wing. Got the feed in from Doug Brown. Brown with it again. Often called Brown off for with Fedorov and the others and Kozlov that he played with. He was just an honorary Russian, Doug Brown.
RJ Crawford, the great Avalanche coach, said he thought that his name was Russian for a while because he'd always hear the fans yelling, Crawford, get off! Crawford, get off!
Chance in down low. Patrick Waugh stopped that on an opportunity from Devereaux. So it's 2-1, the Avalanche in the lead.
There were guys who were policemen on their teams, and there were guys who were just tough. And these are two of the toughest. Adam Foote, Brendan Shanahan, many a battle between these two through the years in that great rivalry between the Avalanche and the Red Wings.
And if pictures are worth a thousand words, say it all.
And of course, Brendan Shanahan, who does a great job with the Toronto Maple Leafs, and Adam Foote, well, helping out with the Avalanche defense, but he's got a couple of kids who play hockey and outstanding players, and he continues to coach locally in this area and does a great job. Avalanche with a chance. Sackick pass in front. And it was turned away. The Red Wings trying to get out of their zone. Avs trying to steal it back. They do, and the chance comes into the corner. Once again, Sackick plays the puck into the slot and scores! Joe Sakic with a nice little pass, and then the shot converted, and the Avalanche lead it 3-1. Well, Sakic's got a goal. He's going to pick up an assist on this play. You can see he goes after it in the boards. Now low in a tip, and Milan Hayduk still got those hands. Ricci will pick up a point as well. And a nice looking tip. Milan Hayduk still got it around the net. I've seen him play in a number of alumni games the last several years after he retired, and he can still shoot the puck, still stick handle. Great, and that time a nice little tip to give the Avs a two-goal advantage.
Yeah, and in the season series, the height of the rivalry, Milan Hayduk had 14 goals in the regular season to Brendan Shanahan 17. So he was the second most and gets one there.
Yeah, he didn't come into the NHL until 1999, just beating the rivalry. Forsberg, centering pass in front, was back to Forsberg. And I think if the guys for the Avalanche, or the fans here, when they were introduced, certainly the fans love Joe Sakic. They love Patrick Waugh, but I think for the Avalanche fans, their favorite has always been Peter Forsberg here in Colorado.
And a career just hampered by the ankle problems that he could never cure.
Went back a couple times to Colorado, just couldn't get past that injury.
As it sent in deep into the Avalanche zone, as the position tried to move that ahead.
Trying to make the pass to Sanders Oslund. Recently played for his home country in the Olympics.
Oh, Patrick Waugh, and it was Cicerelli, side of the net off a feed from Holmstrom, and a diving Patrick Waugh. That was vintage Patrick Waugh right there.
Especially with Cicerelli around the front of the net. Some great battles between those two, Cicerelli and Waugh, in the years before. That time, Waugh making a great save.
And the crowd here at Coors Field chanting Waugh. And the net is off its mooring, so we'll get a stop in play. The feed by Holmstrom. He saw Cicerelli's side of the net, fanned on the first try. Owen got some help from Forsberg defensively. And Cicerelli, being the right-hand shot, was in a perfect spot. Waugh diving over, but I think Forsberg got as much as that. And Dino 600 plus goals in the National Hockey League and the Hockey Hall of Fame. Couldn't bury that one and leaves him shaking his head. Dino, who owns some establishments in the Detroit area now.
All right, the Avalanche on the move with a two-goal lead here in the second period. Hey, Duke. Sakic, Kamensky have scored for Colorado. Steve Yzerman has a first period goal for the Detroit Red Wings.
And he's out there now along with Boyd Devereaux and Doug Brown. Moved ahead by Devereaux for Yzerman. Couldn't get to it. Went off Devereaux and back out to center. Larry Murphy. Devereaux sliced the backhander into the zone. Then Yzerman then tied up by Boyd. He sends a backhander up the near boards and the Avalanche get it back to center ice, and here they come.
On sides, they come into the zone. Coming wide, Messier centering pass. Ends up going wide to the far boards. The Avalanche. Let's go back to the neutral zone to try to get possession. They do get it back. The pass picked off for a moment by the Red Wings. Comes back to Stefan Yell. Sends a pass towards the blue line, and Adam Foote whips the puck around. In behind the net, Messier again for the Avalanche, trying to wrap it around on Legacy. Denied.
Manny Legacy, who does some goaltending coaching in the National Hockey League for Columbus and working with Fox Sports Detroit. Dino Cicerelli, one of the best ever, in front of Patrick Waugh.
And what's so interesting, Kim, when you watch this, you see what Patrick Waugh was doing, what's Foote doing, and it ended up... They gave matching penalties. They gave Cicerelli goaltender interference on this goal. But that was those days. Look at the referee just standing there. Just
they
watching
let him go.
That goal.
Let him go. Yeah, the times are a little different now.
Well, we come to the end of the second period with the Avalanche adding a goal from Milan Hajduk to take a 3-1 lead. All right. Let's go down to the Avs. Bench area. There's Peter McNabb. Peter.
Hey, guys. Thanks very much. Well, Peter, I've been asking all the guys, what kind of memories does this bring back for you? You know, the first time you played these guys in the series, you were just second year in the league. And all of a sudden, you're up against these guys. You know, if your club won this, that series is going to win the Stanley Cup. It must be a special memory playing against these guys.
Yeah, it definitely is. You know, such a good games for a long time there. Not only were the physical, but it was good ice hockey too. You know, fantastic players, skilled, and a lot of guys that wanted to win badly. So, it brings back a lot of memories today. Not only good ones, though, I have to say. There is a few bad ones in there too.
I saw you talking with Nicklas Lidström. Did you two talk during the season, during that rivalry time?
No, not too often, no. I wouldn't say that. You know, there are four or five Swedish guys on that team. I was trying to run every single night, and then you had to see them in the World Championship and Olympics. But, you know, Nicklas is such an awesome guy, though. You know, if you can punch you in the head, you know, you can't still get mad at him. He's such a nice guy, so... But here, it's nice to see him, and I see him a few times in Sweden too, occasionally. So, but all respect not only to him, but the whole Red Wings team. They were great.
Peter, thanks so much.
Thanks, Peter.
Peter Forsberg, he was one of the best in the world at one point. Great to see him and the rest of the Avalanche taking on the Red Wings tonight. The Avs with a two-goal lead after two periods. A little bit of defense there in that second period, Oz.
100%. 3-1 game here. These guys are playing. There's been some neutral zone regroups. There's been a lot of back-checking. There's been shot blocks. I got to tell you, I'm very impressed right now. This is not one of those wide-open 10-9 alumni games. This game is on the line. I feel like the Red Wings are coming back here. Well, third. I really do.
This is the intensity. We wondered if the first period would be able to replicate that in the second, and they've been finishing their checks. I know, it's for an alumni game, that's a finished check. Guys hitting each other, pinning each other on the boards. There's there's Draper with a cross check on the back check. That's unbelievable
this
intensity.
Is awesome.
Yeah, I'm surprised the refs are letting it go.
I didn't even know they were refs.
They better get control of this game.
This has way more intensity than Chicago-Minnesota game. There's cross-checking, yeah. There's hitting behind Adam Foote. That looked like the old days. At the Joe, closing in on the camera, they're taking Chelly out, and Chelly trying to get out of the way. But, wow, so far really impressed here. I'm just hoping the Wings come back in the third.
Hey, speaking of the old days, Patrick Waugh looks like he still got it.
God, you're going to make me say this.
I'm just saying. Come on. Big saves by Patty.
You say it. What do you want me to say? He looks good? It hurts me to say that.
I gave it the pass, too. Sorry, man.
Roll it if we have it. I guess he looks great. So.
No split in the game for him.
Wow. And he might go the full game. That's the scary part. This guy is so competitive, and wow, does he ever look good. And Manny Legacy and Ty Conklin look good as well. I thought Ty Conklin hasn't played a heck of a lot, looks good as well. Stacey Roos didn't have only one, but two consecutive breakaways. I live right by him this summer, and trust me, I'm going to let him know about this. Right, this logo, 100%. I still think Manny, one of the best alumni goalies in the league right now. He plays fabulous every time he plays.
That's what it is, the alumni league. Good idea.
Well, please, no, please. But Patrick Roy here, that's a save too. But most impressive, these guys are moving. They look really good in there.
And there's the competitiveness doing the side stroke. Come on now. That's one where it's a back door and you just look at it and it goes in. No, he's down on the side making the save with the paddle.
These guys certainly look like they're having a lot of fun as the game rolls on. Before the game, our Ken Daniels had a chance to talk with Marty Lapointe and see and check out his temperature back in Colorado. Let's listen in.
I'm with the director of player development for the Montreal Canadiens. Seeing what's gone on in Montreal, this is probably a nice reprieve for you right about now.
Yeah, and you know, it's fun to come back, see the boys from Detroit. It's been a while. Played in 2 years ago in the Comerica Park. It was great. Just to see the guys back, see what they're up to, and just catch up a little bit.
From the time you were with the Red Wings when the rivalry was at its height, you are the penalty minute leader. What game or incident, we can take Draper and Lemieux out of it, stands out most for you in this series?
Well, I think I fought Forsberg, and I think Forsberg was his only fight. And that's a reporter from Montreal that told me that, and I didn't know that. So Forsberg was really a fierce competitor. Every time I went to hit him, I got the worst out of it. So,
well, and to think it was he and Larionov who started the whole darn thing anyway. So thanks for doing this, Marty. Best of luck.
Thanks, Ken.
Ozzy thought he looked like the most interesting man in the world, but I don't know if the most interesting man in the world has guns like that.
Wow, he's been pumping some iron. That's what happens when you're done playing. You don't got to do cardio. Arms and chest constantly. That's what it looks like. Marty, look.
Now you tell me.
Like, look at these arms here. Unreal. Come on, Marty. And this one here as well.
There's he's flexing Ken, the pecs, too.
And there's Ken's arm. Not quite the same, but keep working, Ken. You'll finally get to this right over here. Unreal.
Broadcaster workout on the right.
Look how good Marty looks.
He does.
He is Del Secchi's.
You know, the 100%. arms are, he's yoked, absolutely, but the hands. Missing the hands in the first period, had that wide open net and missed.
And he's got interviewed by John Tortorella. He got the night off, too.
John Tortorella and the most interesting man in the world in conversation back in Colorado as the Avs lead the Red Wings by two after two. Hayduke, Kamensky, and Sackett for the Avs. Eiserman has the Red Wings' lone goal through 40 minutes in the Mile High City. The Stadium Series Alumni Game is brought to you by Ram Trucks. Right now, get a great deal during Ram Truck Month. And by Priority Health, Michigan's healthier approach to health care. Back with more between periods of the Red Wings and Avalanche Stadium Series Alumni Game right after this. Watching the alumni game tonight, but the real deal takes place tomorrow with two huge points on the line for both the Avs and the Red Wings. They'll drop the puck on that one at 7 p.m. on NBC. Chris Osgood, Darren Elliott, Trevor Thompson back with you inside the studios. We're just about to drop the puck on the third period between the Wings and the Avs. Three goals were scored in the first, just one in the second. But on that goal, Joe Sakic picked up his second point of the game, an assist on Milan Hayduk's goal.
Well, Milan Hayduk, it's one of the nicest goals you'll see, never mind an alumni game, just about anywhere. Beautiful reverse pivot on the deflection. And this was all set up by a beautiful neutral zone regroup, Oz.
Absolutely. Red Wings try to get out. Ray Bourque grabs it. Usually when you're coming out of the zone, you head to the bench, regroup the neutral zone. This is an unreal That's deflection. Terrible. Wow. This might make goals of the week somewhere, somehow.
And definitely.
That's an unreal tip off somebody that's a very good defenseman still in Fisher. What a goal. And we're seeing a lot of amazing things in this game from players that have been done playing for a long time. I'm very impressed so far.
And now the adrenaline of that third period. I think that's why the intensity is going to be there for the third period, because the game's close. And so it's going to take over.
What do you think, overtime?
Shootout?
Shootout?
3-on-3.
Put your shootout shooters down right now.
It could be full court press here. Shootout win for the Wings.
Would they go to 3-on-3 overtime?
Oh, you made me go to the WA drop, so now I'm saying 4-3 Wings.
There you go.
Well, you say the intensity is going to pick up. Does that mean Patty WA is going to lift his level a little more?
He can't
would you
play
stop? We're here to talk about the weight. Come on.
This
Matt
guy.
Legacy's going to shut him out in this third period.
There you
period.
Go.
We're
going
to win 4-3, Trev. There enough of the abs.
All
come
right.
On.
Well, they have yet to drop the gloves in this one, but 20 more minutes left for McCarty and Lemieux, part three. The third period is coming your way right after this quick timeout here on Fox Sports Detroit. Enjoy the third, everybody.
And welcome back to the Stadium Series Alumni Game. As the team's back on the ice for the start of the third period, many didn't even head to the dressing room for the 12-minute intermissions, electing just to stay on the benches while they flooded the ice. They're not too old to walk to just off
to the
rooms.
I don't think it's that case.
No.
It's a beautiful night. We've transitioned from those the beautiful blue skies as the game began. Now the sun completely gone in. It's just a perfect setting here outside the Rocky Mountains. We go to the third period of play with the Avs leading 3-1.
And a 6 o'clock start, Colorado time for the game tomorrow. And they were a little bit concerned about the ice this afternoon. The Red Wings cut their practice short, and then they covered up the ice because of the sunshine. But with what's going on tomorrow and a later start, all should be good.
Even warmer tomorrow.
Yeah. What a great night for Patrick Waugh. 21 shots. He made 20 saves. 95 save percentage for the head coach.
I would imagine after the game he's going to go, you know what? That went pretty well.
I guess.
Gave up one goal. Great Steve Yzerman. That's fine. I think Patrick Waugh will be pretty happy with the way that he played through two periods. So we got a new goaltender for the Avs. And we got another goal through for Colorado as well.
It beat Legacy from long range.
Well, it's been a star-studded night in terms of scoring goals for the Avalanche. Kamensky, and it's handed off to Bork after the Avs won the faceoff, and Bork's shot with Kamensky right in front of Legacy gets through. So it didn't touch Kamensky on the way in. How about that? Ray Bork gets the goal for Colorado. Well, Avalanche fans played part of one season after getting traded from the Boston Bruins in that 99-2000 season, came back for one more year, 2000-2001, and from the start, the Avalanche were the best team in the NHL, had the best record at the end of the regular season, and went on to win the Stanley Cup. Did not play the Red Wings in the postseason 2001, and I think anybody who's a hockey fan remembers that iconic moment of Sackett handing Bork the trophy, one of the great Stanley Cup moments. And he's just scored a goal to give the Avs a 3-goal lead.
And one of the great gentlemen of the game, as Brendan Shanahan took a shot. Craig Billington, now in goal for Colorado, juggles that one, trying to find it. And the puck is still loose and clear to the line, but not out. Shanahan over there to try to get it, handed right back to him. In the slot, he gets checked, comes back to the line here for Chelios. That shot got blocked. Ricocheted to the line as Fisher gives it back to Shanahan in a return pass. Sent one in behind the goal for Marty Lapointe. Igor Larionov over to get it. Or Lapointe for Shanahan. Shanahan flipped one to the near side, but taken away by Mike Ricci.
And Ricci moving through center. Chris Cross with Hayduk. He'll just dump it in. A new line coming out for the Avalanche as we check in with Peter McNabb, who is with the goaltender, Patrick Waugh.
Hey, guys, thanks very much. Well, Patrick, just got to ask you, how'd it feel?
It was fun. I had a great time. I mean, the day's been fantastic. I mean, this morning with the players, our team, and then the practice in the morning here, and then tonight with the guys, I mean, it's been fun. I really enjoy myself. I mean, it's the first time I play in front of such a big crowd, and I really love it.
You know, it's a situation where I travel with the club,
yeah,
and I watched you work. You must be very proud of them. You know, how hard you work, so you were able to, because you told me you wanted to enjoy the moment. Were you able to enjoy the moment?
Yes, I have. I mean, I didn't focus too much how I was going to play because of it. I mean, I could look at the crowd, I mean, hearing the fans cheering for our players, and enjoy myself more even before the game, talking with the guys, not just try to be focused on the game, but let myself go. Then this is something that I'm not used to do when I was playing.
You know, and you look around now, and it has been something special. Just talking with some of the Detroit players and all of your guys, this really is something to be proud of for you guys, that you could bring out 50,000 people in an alumni game.
Yeah, but the fans in Denver have always been incredible to us. I mean, yes, we had a great run, but we had them to support us, and that meant a lot to us.
Patrick, thanks so much, and congratulations.
You're very welcome.
Enjoy the third period.
Yes, I will. Thank you.
Okay, guys, back to you.
So even alumni games come down to goaltending. Shots 22-11 in favor of Detroit, and yet the score by three here for Colorado. You know, I love Patrick Roy when he was a kid. Not even 10 years old, he said he used to sit on his bed with his hockey cards and knew that goaltenders always had to have a mask, so he'd put scotch tape over the card to resemble a mask and always wanted to be a goaltender. His son, Jonathan, was a goaltender for a time and played for him as well in Quebec, and now he's a musician working with Corey Hart.
Well, Patrick Roy didn't get a shutout in those two periods of work. Came kind of close, giving up just one goal. But you look at the great goaltending we saw through the years between these two teams.
And Dominik Hasek in back-to-back shutouts as the Red Wings came back in the series in 0-2. And that was the Statue of Liberty game and the 7-0 for Patrick when Brendan Shanahan scored. Patrick Roy had a nice night here tonight. Well,
I like what he said. It was an opportunity. We didn't get a chance to do it when he played, to really just kind of soak in the atmosphere and watch. And we're going to have a penalty shot here. And it's Holmstrom who's taking it.
Yeah, and in the alumni game at Comerica Park, too. So Thomas Holmstrom is in, and Craig Billington stops him.
Craig Billington, who spent some time as the backup goaltender for Patrick Roy, won some big games when he had to come in and fill in for Patrick Roy, makes a great save on this penalty shot.
And he uses pretty much a straight stick. Thomas Holmstrom does. And Craig Billington stayed with him as he went to the backhand and made the save, so it remains 4-1.
At center, the Avalanche break up a pass. Fisher takes it back for Detroit.
And gives it to Chris Chelios. Steve Yzerman, who has the lone goal for the Red Wings. Only man to beat Patrick Roy. Billington with a save there. As the Red Wings continue to pile on the shots. Can't get the puck to go through. Stacey Roost had two marvelous opportunities in the second period. Dino Cicerelli checked by Forsberg, and Roy getting over at another great chance but couldn't bury it. Got free there by Draper. Chris Draper not wearing the C, but one of the so-called captains of this alumni team, helping putting this roster together, a special assistant with the Red Wings to Ken Holland. Fisher moved it back to the line for Chelios. Shot through, Chelios gets it again. Look back into the high slot, and there's Draper back to the line for Fisher. Just 35 years old, taken in the same draft as Brad Stewart. So all but for the heart issues for Yuri Fisher, you'd think he could be playing still to this day for sure. In his absence, and the Red Wings had to give up some first-round picks just to try to negate the loss of Yuri Fisher, who would have been a stud on that Red Wing blue line. 43,319 taking in this Stadium Series alumni game here at Coors Field. And Kirk Maltby mic'd up for us here tonight. Kirk, what do you think of this game so far, besides the fact your team's down by three? How's the pace?
We're trying to not get injured out here, but we couldn't get it past Patty. Had lots of chances in the first two periods, and Watt made some good saves. But just like I tell my son in hockey, there's no safe lead, and I think that holds true for these alumni games too.
Still ready to go. Is altitude affecting you guys? That you're not really advanced age, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. No, it's not too bad. I think everyone's trying to go hard and go short and hard. Let everyone get as many shifts as possible, but. Maybe if the outcome is not in our favor, I think maybe that'll be one of our main excuses.
Any real chirping? There's going to be another penalty coming here, or a penalty shot as it happens.
Yeah, it looks like they're getting a penalty shot. So, hey, real quick, I got to give a little shout-out to my daughter, Ella, and my other daughter, Leighton, and son, Landon.
Well done. You just did it. We'll, we'll let you go, and we'll get the penalty shot here. Thanks for doing
cool.
that.
Yeah.
So in lieu of a penalty shot. So Thomas Holmstrom was stopped for the Red Wings, and Manny Legacy will face the upcoming penalty shot here for Colorado. Mike Ricci will take it.
So it's going to be Mike Ricci. Moment ago, Billington saved Holmstrom. Now it is Ricci's turn to take a penalty shot. Smoothly coming in, fakes the slap shot, cuts across, and his shot goes wide, and they slam the stick against the glass after not scoring on his penalty shot chance. Well, both teams have had a chance on the penalty shot. Goaltenders, though, made the save. It's still...
Well, Danny, first of all, back with Danny Heino. Danny, how's the body feel after 50 minutes?
It feels as good as it used to feel, if that tells you anything. That's not good.
You know, we've been talking a lot with everybody, but just the rivalry. What did this rivalry mean to you?
Well, you know, to me, I came here in the middle of it, you know, so I got to be a fan before I was a part of it. So to me, I think it's extra special because I was such a big fan of it prior, and then I got called up right in the middle of it. So to me, it's something I'll never forget and explain to my kids someday.
Yeah, you know, I've been watching the players' reactions as the game's gone along. And, you know, you haven't been together, you haven't played as a team, but there's a team feeling on this bench that really has been remarkable to watch.
Yeah, it really is. You know, it's like riding a bike. As soon as you see these guys in the hotel lobby, it's like right back into the old swing. Same jokes, same funny guys. I mean, it's like I said, it's like feeling home.
Do you ever, is there anything you hold back?
Come back.
With the teammates as far as things that are said?
Oh, God, no. Nothing is off limits. Nothing can be put on TV, mind you, but nothing is off limits, that's for sure.
Well, you watched Mr. Waugh have a pretty good performance in goal.
Oh, my God, it was fantastic. It was like the old days where you felt like you could pretty much do anything out here because you had him behind you to take care of all your messes.
You know, we've been talking about a couple of things because, you know, your good friend Peter Forsberg, obviously a long time removed, but he does bring back the memories of how his game was when he was on his game.
Oh, yeah, because that never leaves him. You know what I mean? It's like Michael Jordan shooting hoops. Like, you never lose that touch. The stuff that he can do, the little stuff with the puck, just makes you shake your head, even at this level.
Well, Danny, thanks so much. Enjoy.
I appreciate it.
Guys?
Forsberg had the puck there, and he made a dish, and that shot goes wide. And it was interesting listening to Dan Heino talk about the fact that Peter Forsberg can still do all those little things that players love to watch.
As Thomas Holmstrom went right into Craig Billington along with Raymond Bork. So remember, Bork hit Holmstrom earlier in the game, back of the net, and Thomas Holmstrom drives the goal right here, driving Raymond Bork right into Craig Billington. Just like the old times. Thomas Holmstrom has been pretty good. Thomas Holmstrom is mentioned in the construction business now back in Sweden. He'll always offer his input if he notices some players over there to his former general manager, Ken Holland.
Well, certainly Detroit had a lot of great Swedish players coming through their organization.
Well, and there's another player on the Red Wings who looks at a lot of players because he's an agent now, and he's standing by with Mickey Redmond.
Igor Larionov, you've seen Holmstrom do that a few times over the years.
Well, it was funny. You know, funny. Homer was trying to push like two guys into the net, so that was an amazing move.
You played a lot of alumni games. How's the pace out there?
Good. It's actually a very good game, so it's a nice pace and competitive level tonight. So hopefully we can get a couple of goals and get tied up the game. So
you did say they're playing a lot of defense or blocking a lot of shots.
Well, that's amazing to me. So they're going down on the shots, and also they keep like five guys around the net. So it's just to me, like, for this kind of hockey, it's amazing to see.
And you're a happy guy because you're the second oldest on the team behind Cicerelli. Way to go. Well, good to see you back.
Thank you very much, Mickey. Thank you. Nice to be back.
Back to you guys.
Thank you, Mick, with the professor. As that will get a whistle, and the Red Wings have surpassed 30 shots already. Colorado with 16, but have the four goals.
And we're seeing more and more action around the net. We just heard Larionov talking about the Avs are going down blocking shots, and there's charging towards the net from both sides. And, you know, the competitive just doesn't leave this rivalry.
And Dave Lewis, Mickey Redmond, and Barry Smith changing up their lines here in period number three to try to get some scoring going here despite all the shots. There's a Red Wing coaching staff and worked so well with Scotty Bowman. Barry Smith still with the Chicago Blackhawks.
I like the fact that when you see the sort of those team jackets, they got all the autographs on the sleeves. That's great. There's a chance, and the glove save made by Legacy. An opportunity for Colorado. Sandis Oslund, wow, he can still get involved. When they talk about offensive defensemen, Sandis Oslund, in terms of the Avalanche, best there ever was that played for the Avs. Talked to him not that long ago, a couple months ago, when he was in town, and he said he still found it so fascinating that he would find himself in spots offensively down near the net and coming back, and all the players would love to talk about what he contributed to the Avalanche during those years.
On the wing, and a shot from Brown was handled by Billington. Nick Lidstrom out there on defense for the Red Wings. Loose in front of the goal, and a shot blocked in front again as Shanahan and Devereaux had a chance. Marty Lapointe turning to play defense now along with Lidstrom, who's scouting for Team Sweden, what with the World Cup coming up this September in Toronto, and the teams to be announced this coming week. And then Nick Lidstrom on the Swedish staff. Chance through for Lariana, back in front, Shanahan scores! It's a 4-2 game on a feed in front. Lariana to Shanahan, and it's a two-goal deficit for the Red Wings. Billington made the first save. Larionov hopped on the rebound, and Brendan Shanahan buried that. So two goals is the Avalanche lead. We're back to Coors Field in a moment. Take you back in time to 2002. Steve Yzerman with the chance, and the puck is loose. Patrick Waugh thought he had it. Is it hot dogging? Well, yes. And Brendan Shanahan knocked it in the infamous Statue of Liberty. And then the Red Wings came back, won that game six, on to game seven, and a 7-0 game, and a big game for Sergei Fedorov that night, who couldn't make this game. Sergei would have loved to have played as the both teams salute the fans here in Denver.
Oh, is that ever cool? Okay.
All right, the Avalanche have the puck to resume play. 4-2 game. Red Wings just got a goal from Brendan Shanahan. They have outshot the Colorado in this game 35-16, but Colorado first in the and second period. Got terrific goaltending from Patrick Waugh. Heydu trying to go wide around Fisher. He's got him pinned up against the boards. And the Red Wings, Shanahan with the outlet pass.
Brendan Shanahan, 13th and NHL goes to the net there. 656 for Brendan. He's made it a 4-2 game here.
Heyduk to center ice for the Avalanche. He's got a goal in this one. Pass down the slot. It's broken up by the Red Wings.
Deliberately into the zone. Larionov stops up high. Put one in that's knocked down by Colorado, and the Avalanche will try to turn it back up ice.
Forsberg on the receiving end of a pass, but he was getting hooked. So he lost the puck, and the Red Wings have it again.
Just too far as Knubel couldn't pick it up, but it's into the Colorado zone. Knubel knocked it down, goes after it again as Larry Murphy up there along with Brown.
Get an odd man rush going. The pass by Gametzky tipped in front by Lemieux, but it goes wide. Now the corner pass by Lemieux for Gametzky. Fires a shot to save by Legacy. Forsberg with it for the Avalanche. Back up top from the point foot. Lemieux. And lost the puck to Cicerelli.
And they'll dump it back down ice. Yzerman and company will go for a change as Billington tees it up for the Avalanche with under 3.5 to go here in the third period. A wide edge in shots for the Red Wings, but has not resulted in goals. Colorado with 17 and the Red Wings with 35 shots.
And the Avalanche with the puck again. Hooked out to center by Adam Foote back into the Red Wings zone.
Stacey Roost out there. He had a couple of great chances along with Thomas Holmstrom, who was denied on a penalty shot. And Cicerelli for Detroit as Billington stopped it back of the goal. Moving in is Roos trying to take it away. It was moved past Cicerelli as Dandenault pinches in. Matthew Dandenault working for French language television in Montreal, working hockey games.
Here's a two-on-one for the Avalanche. The shot, the save by Legacy, the rebound, and scored! What an effort there by Stefan Yao, making it 5-2 for the Avalanche. Well, he may not have gotten a lot of the accolades some of the other centermen did for the Avalanche when you're playing with Sakic, when you're playing with Forsberg, but Stefan Yao, defensively, and year in, year out, such a valuable part of the Avalanche team, and a nice goal for Stefan Yao to give the Avs their 5-2 advantage.
Well, Chris Osgood, who's come off hernia surgery and couldn't play in this game, I can almost hear him now saying, I'm glad that's not me. But he would have been great, for sure. So the Avalanche making the most of their chances.
I think the Avalanche fans would have loved a chance to boo him.
I think so. And then I would have loved to have seen Chris Osgood and Patrick Waugh come to center ice again. And he did a great interview with Patrick a few years back to Chris Osgood when they talked about that fight and how Patrick was his willingness to win. And as Chris's eyes opened wide, coming with Patrick at center. So Bork getting the assist. Raymond Bork also has a goal, 17:40. For that goal.
Well, I know, you know, before this game, a while ago, I was talking with Joe Sakic, and he said, you know what, I'm probably good for 1-1.
Oh, you got it.
You got it.
Yeah.
You got it. You got it. Goal, got an assist. Forsberg got an assist.
And of the Red Wings.
Another penalty shot here?
And of the Red Wings scorers, weren't sure that either Shanahan or Yzerman would be able to play, and they both scored the goals.
They did great. Going there, and I think some of the, you know, fans want to see a little physical play as well. It wasn't like a typical NHL All-Star game. We saw some hits here.
It didn't disappoint, really, except for the Red Wings side of things. Yes, the score, but overall for the game, and the Red Wings had their chance to score and some physical play involved. The only thing we didn't get to was a fight, although some thought maybe there might be a little something.
Well, we still have the handshakes at the end of the game.
Oh, that's true.
So
we'll have to watch Claude Lemieux and Draper. Cicerelli, for sure. That's right.
Well, running time, so the clock's not going to stop, and the Avs are going to end up with the victory in front of their large home crowd here. There's 50,000 folks at Coors Field on a beautiful night here in Denver, and the Avalanche do get the victory. Stefan Yao got that last goal for the Avalanche. And Craig Billington, surrounded by his teammates, he held that lead.
Yes.
For his good friend, Patrick Waugh. And the Avalanche get the win 5-2 as the fireworks go off here in Denver at Coors Field.
A terrific game that really did live up to its billing. The Stadium Series Alumni Game. One of the most heated rivalries in National Hockey League history. And we saw some great plays here tonight. And as we just showed you, some physical play. And from Patrick Waugh, terrific goaltending. But you wouldn't expect much less from him.
All right, well, I'm interested in this handshake, Tony.
Yep.
Aren't you, Ken?
I am.
Well, and you see the team starting to line up and the handshake's beginning. There's the coach, Adam Denmark, for the Avalanche, a great power forward for Colorado, who did the coaching today. And Claude Lemieux, we see him making his way through the line. Curtis Lecision. And there's the coaches for the Detroit Red Wings. And the handshakes continue. See Rob Blake, Greg DeVries, defenseman for Avs. There's Claude Lemieux, taking hands with Larry Onoff and Kirk Moltke.
And Marty Lapointe, Steve Yzerman.
Continue to watch Claude Lemieux shake hands with the guys that he had all those battles with through all those years. Still plenty more Red Wings to come on this handshake for Claude Lemieux and the rest of the Avalanche. There's Cicerelli.
They
did, shake,
Cicerelli.
They did shake hands.
Yeah.
Cicerelli had the great quote when Flavy shook the hand of Claude Lemieux after the 96 series. And there it is. There's Darren McCarty and Claude Lemieux.
They've done a couple of autograph signings together.
They figured a way to get along, haven't they?
Yeah.
All right, let's check in down at the ringside. Is Adam Foote with Peter McNabb. Peter?
Yeah, here we go. No, they got a picture. You know what? Let him run over and get a picture, guys, so he wants to come right back.
All right, Adam Foote. Always a central piece of the rivalry, and so they're winning Avalanche team. Getting a little team photo. So Detroit has had these alumni games. They've been involved in this. This is the first time that Colorado has had this, either as a road team. And, you know, there was some discussion when the Avs were awarded the Stadium Series, who would you play? And Joe Sakic said, there's never any doubt who you have to have as your opponent if you're going to host it at the Colorado Avalanche. It had to be the Detroit Red Wings.
And as great as this rivalry is, and the Red Wings were outdoors, the alumni game with the Toronto Maple Leafs in two games because there were so many players, in fact, so they divided it up by years, the older generation and the not-so-old that year. But this terrific, and we can check in again with Peter McNabb.
Hey, thanks very much, guys. Well, Adam, look around. I mean, I can't imagine what's going through your mind right now as you look here. You played this game. You saw the old rivals. It's got to be pretty cool.
Well, you know, just the rivalry is amazing. It's good that we won that. But I love the hockey fans here. What a venue. They put on a great show. And it's so nice to see the fans support us.
You know what? Go get in that picture and come on back. Guys, he's catching all the souvenirs he can.
Now we get the big picture with both teams together.
Who would have ever thought?
I was just going to say, Ken, if you went back to about year 2002, would you ever think that you could see these guys together, smiles, getting along, and happy following a game? I never thought that we would see this day.
No. Okay. See that?
No, never. I mean, it was getting chippy there, but it's one of those games they wanted to win. We wanted to win, and you know what? You got to play this type of game. You can't. Sometimes physicality is involved, and I think the fans loved it.
Oh, the fans loved it. No question about it. When it was first understood that you're going to play the alumni game, this city just went crazy. But I guess the final question for me is, what did this series mean to you inside of your career? Because it was such a big part of it.
Well, you know what? For guys like me that didn't get a lot of points, so when you're playing many series against top teams like Detroit and Dallas and things like that, you get a chance to be seen and get recognized. And I was just fortunate to be a part of such an unbelievable core coming over from Quebec. And, Pierre Lacroix made some good moves. And that Lindros trade was a great thing for us. And it built our core, and we were able to win two cups. And if it wasn't for Detroit, we might have a couple more.
Adam, enjoy the rest of the night. Thanks so much. And thanks for bringing back so many memories. You betcha. Mr. Redmond?
Yes, sir. Thanks, guys. What a salute that was, Brendan. Both teams stood up. The crowd was mentioned as thanks for the rivalry, and they went crazy. And then at the end, you guys salute. How about the venue here today?
Well, yeah, it's... I still don't like the score, the outcome, but it was great. And sitting there at a face-off at one point, I look back on their blue line, and there's Ray Bourque and Rob Blake. And I'm thinking, I don't know how much of an old-timer game this feels like with those two guys back there, but it was a real vicious, violent, passionate, skillful era in hockey when these two teams were at the top of their game.
It was, in all seriousness, it was a pretty high pace right from the get-go, wasn't it?
Today? Both teams wanted it. Like I said, I don't like the outcome. It really sort of bothered me, but both teams wanted it. Both teams were back-checking, and as best as us old guys can do.
And it can't get old putting a puck in the net like you did again today.
Oh, it always feels a little good, but, like I said, we're... people are not kind to us when they call these alumni games. They're old-timer games. They're old-timers. So it's nice to get through it, and I think I'll get to the dressing room without pulling too many muscles.
Thanks, Brendan. Nice to see you back.
Thank you.
Take it away, guys.
All right.
So the Avs take the Stadium Series alumni game by a final of 5-2. Ozzie, give me your initial thoughts looking back at this one.
Fabulous game. I mean, this was a highly contested game for an alumni game. Back-checking, like we said, the Red Wings were having troubles getting the inside. Colorado was blocking shots. They're in a trap system the third period.
Well, they had three guys skating backwards, as you said. They were protecting the house. There were five guys in the crease around Billington.
I don't believe it for a second. They weren't practicing together.
No,
they sandbagged the Red Wings, like you said. I truly believe it. I mean, they had a system going. They're forechecking two guys, and they go to one guy. It was that was a well-organized alumni game, probably the best one you're ever going to see.
They probably took Patrick Roy, the head coach. They took his whiteboard. They used it. But you're right. Joe Sakic was in town here, and he was saying, oh, you guys have the leg up on us. All the guys are right here. You get to skate and practice together all the time. We're just going to throw the thing together. Not a chance. They obviously had practiced together.
No way. They're organized. And I did see Ken Daniels blame the goaltending again. As always, they get, come on. It's an alumni game.
Well, let's
Manny
break it down,
and Ty Conklin both played great for the Red Wings. It's never easy. Both goals, they went on a Manny, no chance. Ty Conklin, come on. Sakic's going to score. Nowadays, on the goalies in the league with that shot, unreal shot. No chance in the first one for Conklin either. Really, I thought all the goalies played really well. Billington, unreal in the third period.
That old school. Old school. Billington with a stand-up style. I liked it. And, you know, he really had to go. That's tough. You sit there for two periods. The game's on the line. Everybody could see it was hotly contested. You have to go in there and win the game. And he just did that for his guys.
And in front of, what, 43,000 people when you haven't played for 10 years. It's not an easy thing to do, but
this is a nice play.
Yeah, this is the one I thought Conk should have had earlier. Kaminsky with a quick snapper just gets by him. Conk's played great as well, but Patrick Waugh, no chance. Good to see Stevie score, though. Darren Wild, good to see him out there with the Red Wings back in the red. Great drive, middle lane drive in the game by Danino. Outstanding.
And then this is the shot you're talking about. I don't care who you are, what area you're from. Joe Sakic with the twisted wrister up top on the short side.
And we talked. There's one thing with these guys. They might lose their speed a bit. These guys do not lose their hands or their shooting
the
ability.
There.
And that's an unreal tip. Great play by Rec Ricci. And there, what a tip by Hadou. Come on. That's ridiculous as well here. And now we're screening goalies in an alumni.
Dan Hynek with the perfect net front presence. It wasn't even the term back in the day. It was just screening
the
goalie.
There's no way Gilles Meloche was screened by Chicago in that game last week. Unreal here. And here's Shanny. Quick release here. You're Igor Larionov. He's my favorite 55-year-old in the world right now.
Well, there
always
you go.
Is. Looks great. What quick hands here.
From both.
Manny, the quick save there. And then the rebound, no chance at all with big Chris Simon, who looks like he could still beat some tough guys in the National Hockey League right now driving the net. Red Wings' Steve Duchene couldn't get back on the back check there after getting caught up, but no chance for the goalies and entities. And thumbs up to each and every one of those guys. All four of them played great in the nets.
So you're looking forward to the next...
Oh, my ever. I'm starting to train tomorrow. Side-to-side dry land training. Tomorrow morning, 8 a.m.
So, guys, we just had a look at the plays of the game. They were brought to us by Toyota. Who was the player of the game, in your opinion, Oz?
Wow, I know what you want me to say, but I refuse to go. I'm going to go all-star in Boston, one of my all-star games I played in. He was the MVP of the game, scored the late goal on Felix Potvin in Boston. Ray Bourque, I thought, was unreal, keeping pucks in. A lot of plays. Great defensively as well. There's certain guys, and I put Markell in this category, no matter how old they get, they can still skate. They don't lose their ability to play the game. I thought Ray Bourque looked great out there.
How about you, Darren?
I like Mike Ricci. He kind of embodied what this game was all about. That these teams were good because of the star players, but these teams were great in their era because of their bottom six forwards. We used to just call it the third and fourth line. The bottom six forwards, as we talk about today. Mike Ricci, good plays today. Played honest hockey just like he did as a player. That's what made these two teams special.
Joe Sakic got to be the guy for me. He got a goal and an assist. Of course, his hometown fans got to love to see him back in action wearing number 19, leading his team to victory over the Red Wings, the final 5-2 in the Stadium Series alumni game. And if you want to watch a replay of that, tune back in here to Fox Sports Detroit at midnight, and you can catch it all over again. For Darren and Ozzie and everybody else here inside the studio, thanks for watching, everybody. Glad to have you with us on this Friday evening. And here, before we leave you, we'll leave you with the best of today's action. It's the final take. Enjoy, everybody. Avs 5, Red Wings 2 in the Stadium Series alumni game.